Test one.
Thank you.
Quorum being present, the Committee on Education and the Workforce will come to order. Good morning. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our witnesses. We appreciate you joining us today, all of you, to discuss ways to strengthen career and technical education. It's an important conversation to have because of the critical role career and technical education programs play in a student's education and, more importantly, in their future. Through the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Act, the federal government supports state and local programs designed to prepare high school and community college students for technical careers. These programs offer students the knowledge and training they need to compete in the workforce and hold jobs in a wide range of fields. In other words, they offer opportunities for young men and women to pursue a lifetime of success. This is an important conversation to have now because an anemic economy has made good-paying jobs hard to come by. In fact, today, millions of Americans are struggling to find employment, and millions of others who need full-time jobs can only find part-time work. For young people entering this kind of job market, having the right skills and experience is essential. Career and technical education programs can provide these critical tools, and we have to ensure federal support for these programs is delivered in the most efficient and effective manner possible. As we have learned in recent years, through hearings and other activities, there are certainly opportunities to improve the law. This is an important area where Republicans and Democrats should work together to deliver reforms that will strengthen support for all Americans, but particularly young Americans. That collaboration is exactly what happened in 2014 with the bipartisan Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. We worked together to help put Americans back to work by improving an outdated and inefficient job training program. Last year, a similar commitment to finding common ground guided our efforts to improve K-12 education. The result was the Every Student Succeeds Act, a law that empowers parents, teachers, and state and local leaders to deliver the quality education every child deserves. It's time we applied the same approach to strengthening career and technical education. But more importantly, we need to apply many of the same principles reflected in our efforts to improve K-12 education and workforce development. What does that mean in practical terms? It means empowering state and local leaders to innovate and respond to the unique economic and education needs in their communities. They know better than anyone, certainly better than any of us in Washington, what it takes to meet the needs of their students, workers, and employers. It means equipping students with the skills they need for today's in-demand jobs, not the skills that were needed in yesterday's workforce. We have to make sure federal resources are aligned with the needs of the local workforce and the demands of new and emerging businesses. It also means strengthening transparency and accountability, providing parents, students, business leaders, community stakeholders, and taxpayers the information they need to hold their programs accountable. It isn't good enough for students to simply complete a program. Once they've done so, they should be ready to further their education or pursue a good-paying job. Finally, it means ensuring a limited federal role. Restricting the federal government's ability to intervene in matters that should be left up to the states will enable state and local leaders to spend less time meeting the demands of Washington and more time meeting the needs of people in their local communities. These are the kinds of reforms that we know work, the kinds of reforms that will help students succeed in the classroom and in the future. For many individuals, entering the workforce can be scary enough on its own. For the young men and women entering today's workforce, a slew of technological advances, global changes, and economic challenges make finding a good job even more daunting. That's why it's so important for us to continue working together to ensure students have what they need to achieve success. Strengthening career and technical education should be the next step in that important effort. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses as we continue our work to strengthen the Perkins Act. And with that, I recognize Ranking Member Bobby Scott for his opening remarks.
Good morning, and thank you, Chairman Klein. We're here today to discuss the critical role of career and technical education, or CTE, in preparing our nation's students for success in the 21st century workforce. The federal investment in CTE is authorized under the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Improvement Act of 2006, and I'm hopeful that today's hearing will serve as a foundation for a bipartisan, comprehensive reauthorization of this important law. Research is clear. The United States is suffering from a skills gap due to our failure to produce enough skilled workers to meet future economic needs. According to the Georgetown University Center on Education and the Workforce, by 2020, 65% of all jobs in the United States will require some sort of post-secondary education or training. Yet, at its current production rate, the United States will fall approximately 5 million workers short of this by 2020. Investing in high-quality CTE and increasing access to these programs through the reauthorization of the Perkins CTE must be prioritized as a partial solution to this, to bridge this gap. The CTE provides students with knowledge and skills needed to both needed to be career and college ready. It is not a the vocational education of the past. Today's CTE fosters educational environments that engage students with an integrated curriculum of core academic content and real-world work-based relevance. And I'm proud to say that my home state of Virginia is a leader in CTE, with more than 500,000 6th through 12th graders participating in CTE across the Commonwealth. Now, Virginia's expanded access to CTE programs that equip secondary school students with recognized post-secondary credentials through innovative programs such as dual enrollment and registered apprenticeships. As we move forward with reauthorization, we must prioritize robust investment in high-quality CTE programs in each and every state in order to maintain our nation's status as a leader in the global economy. The globalization of the marketplace has altered the way the United States and other countries compete for business. We certainly cannot compete with other countries when it comes to lowest wages, when many around the world will work for a couple of dollars or even pennies a day. Nor can we compete in terms of location with today's technology, video conferencing, smartphones, and tablets. Any worker that can work across the hall from their coworkers can work across the globe from their coworkers. The main reason that the United States remains strong and continues to attract businesses is because we have a well-educated and well-trained workforce. Our focus on equitable access and high standards for all students, a system that focuses on college and career-ready results, is an economic asset. And while many of today's CTE programs are successfully providing students with the skills and knowledge that today's employers demand, there's more to be done to ensure that each and every CTE program is delivering the results for students, for industry, and for our national economy. We must do more to spur innovation in the delivery of CTE. We need to reward and replicate programs achieving positive results for students and industry to ensure that CTE is positioned to drive economic success, enhance workforce alignment, and increase collaboration between secondary and post-secondary educational institutions, industry, employers, and community partners. While successful CTE programs must meet labor market demands, they must also work for students. They must prepare them to succeed in in-demand jobs that offer living wages, employer benefits, and opportunities for meaningful career advancement. This requires renewed focus to ensure the opportunity for all students, especially historically disadvantaged students, to benefit from CTE programs that are relevant, rigorous, and high quality. In recent years, this committee, along with our Senate colleagues, completed successful bipartisan reauthorization of two major laws which we must align with Perkins CTE. I'm confident that bipartisanship and shared commitment to equity in education embodied in both the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act and the Every Student Succeeds Act will produce a bipartisan reauthorization of Perkins CTE that empowers states, school districts, and will make quality CTE available to all students with the guidance and support of the Department of Education. It is our obligation to prioritize equity of opportunity when it comes to participating in and benefiting from quality CTE programs, and we must preserve and improve program accountability. The federal government has an important role to play in setting high expectations for both for the systems and for the students those systems serve. In addition, we must maintain vigorous oversight and enforcement to ensure that those expectations matter. So, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to thank you for holding this hearing. I'd like to thank all of our witnesses for coming to testify today. I eagerly await their testimony, as they are all uniquely positioned to provide insight into the challenges, successes, and future of career and technical education. And lastly, I look forward to working with you, Mr. Chairman, and the committee on a bipartisan effort to modernize federal support for CTE through the reauthorization of the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Act of 2006. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. Pursuant to Committee Rule 7C, all members will be permitted to submit written statements to be included in the permanent hearing record. And without objection, the hearing record will remain open for 14 days to allow such statements and other extraneous material referenced during the hearing to be submitted for the official hearing record. We are now going to turn to the introductions of our distinguished witnesses. And Mr. Scott, I understand you will introduce our first witness.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased to introduce Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia, a good friend and inspirational leader from the Commonwealth of Virginia. He's a longtime advocate for education, and his life's journey is a tribute to the power of career and technical education programs. Now he is the founder and co-chair of the bipartisan CTE caucus in the Senate. He focuses on improving access to CTE programs to ensure that students of all ages are prepared with skills necessary for the 21st century workforce. His commitment to public education runs in his family. His wife, Anne, is also a personal friend, and she serves as the Commonwealth's Secretary of Education. His father-in-law, former Governor Linwood Halton, is also a strong advocate of equal educational opportunities. So I want to thank Senator Kaine for his leadership in the Senate to ensure that last year's bipartisan Every Student Succeeds Act included provisions to strengthen school career counseling programs and encourage alignment between general career and technical education programs to better serve students. He also was involved in the reauthorization as he championed provisions to empower local school districts to deliver instruction in interpersonal and relationship skills, key foundation employability skills, or soft skills that are often too lacking in high school graduates. He grew up working in his father's iron working shop in Kansas City, educated at University of Missouri and Harvard Law School, started his public service career by taking a year off from Harvard to run a technical school founded by Jesuit missionaries in Honduras. I'm sure we'll hear more from the senator during his testimony about how these and other real-world experiences shaped his future. And so, Senator Kaine, I've known for many years, as I've indicated. About the same time I was getting elected to Congress, he was getting elected to city council in Richmond, then mayor of Richmond, then lieutenant governor, then governor, and now a senator from Virginia. And I don't think we've heard the last of them. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman. And Senator, thank you for being here. I understand that, although I do notice you're sliding down in the elected political scale here, but thank you for being here with us today. I understand you need to leave before 11 o'clock. We'll be mindful of that as we go forward. It's now my pleasure to introduce our remaining witnesses. Mr. Paul Say is a project manager with Shapiro & Duncan, Inc. in Rockville, Maryland. Mr. Say attended the Thomas Edison High School of Technology in Montgomery, Maryland. His experience at Thomas Edison helped prepare him for an HVAC job with Shapiro & Duncan. In his 12 years with the company, Mr. Say has gone on to become a project manager and was part of the leadership team that recently oversaw a $60 million HVAC installation. Mr. Jason Bates is an administration manager with Toyota Bodine Aluminum in Jackson, Tennessee. Mr. Bates is the administration manager for Toyota's Bodine Aluminum, which supplies aluminum die-cast engine parts for the company's North American powertrain production. He oversees the implementation of Toyota's Advanced Manufacturing Technician Program in Tennessee. The AMT program provides students the opportunity to earn a work-related associate's degree while working part-time. And Dr. Monty Sullivan is president of the Louisiana Community and Technical College System in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Dr. Sullivan has been president of the Louisiana Community and Technical College System since February 2014. Prior to serving as president, he was the chancellor of Delgado Community College in New Orleans. He has been a leader in Louisiana's effort to address workforce needs through the targeted application of Perkins Act and state workforce development funding. Welcome, all of you. Before I recognize each of you to provide your testimony, let me just go over our highly complicated lighting system. We allow 5 minutes for each witness to provide testimony. When you begin, the light in front of you will turn green. When 1 minute is left, the light will turn yellow, and at the 5 minute mark, the light will turn red, and then please try to wrap up your testimony. I am loath to gavel down witnesses, certainly during their opening testimony, but you can see we have a number of members that we want to get through. These members will each have 5 minutes to ask questions, and I hope I can hold with that. But that means I will not be hesitant to gavel down that five-minute time. So let's get started. Senator Kaine, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Ranking Member Scott and committee members. I'm so pleased that you're holding this hearing and honored that you'd ask me to testify. Congratulations also on WIOA and ESSA. These are two big accomplishments, and we hope that we can work together, obviously, to reauthorize Perkins. Congressman Scott described my own personal background in this area. My dad ran an ironworker organized ironworking and welding shop in the stockyards of Kansas City, Missouri. And my two brothers and I and my mom grew up all working in that business. In a tough year, there would be 5 employees. In a great year, there would be 7 or 8 employees. It was a classic small business. But I learned from my father, as the owner, he would always teach us that his business acumen would help his great welders and ironworkers educate their kids, but their technical mastery would help him educate his kids. It was a partnership, and that's what's so good about this topic. It truly is a partnership. Years later, when I was at law school at Harvard and not sure what I wanted to do with my life, I volunteered to go work with Jesuit missionaries in Honduras. They saw that I was at Harvard Law School and determined that would have no relevance to anything they were doing. But when they realized I had worked in an ironworking shop, they said, run a vocational school, the Instituto Tecnico Loyola in El Progreso, 1980-81. It was a school that taught kids to be welders and carpenters. These early experiences taught me the power of career and technical education. But then back here, as I was going through schooling and even watching my own kids go through schooling, I saw a contrast. The schools I went to in Kansas City didn't emphasize career and technical education. In fact, the vocational education track was kind of sometimes used for kids that had been probably wrongly determined not to be college material. I saw this in my own children's education as they were going through the public schools in Richmond. There was maybe a little bit of a better attitude, but still not an embrace of it. And I remember when I was running for lieutenant governor, a good friend, Gigi Pippin, who's a middle school educator in Wise County, Virginia, said to me, I will sometimes see my kids after they're in middle school and high school, and I'll ask them what they're doing. And sometimes my kids say, I'm in vocational education, and slump their shoulders almost as if they're ashamed to tell me that that's what they're doing. Well, clearly CTE is important, but clearly for a variety of reasons, we haven't emphasized its importance. When I was governor of Virginia, I worked hard with Democrats and Republicans to change that trajectory. We dramatically increased the number of our young people who are getting industry certifications. And as much as I would like to say it was because there was a good governor, frankly, there was a renaissance going on in every one of our 134 city and county school systems. People were starting to embrace again the notion of technical education. We started, when I was governor, governor's career and technical academies. We had governor's schools, 17 regional magnet governor's schools that would prepare kids for college. And when I ran for governor, I said, well, why can't we call a great career and technical education program a governor's school? Just the label, just to shine the spotlight. By the time I was done as governor, there were 9. The governor who followed me, Governor McDonald, took it up to 23. The governor who's followed him, Terry McAuliffe, is adding to it again. There's a renaissance and people around the state get it. In the Senate, I came to the Senate and I wanted to be on the HELP committee and I didn't get put on. But what I realized is you don't have to be on the committee, just pick an issue that nobody on the committee is yet championing. And so I chose CTE education. And I did what any smart senator would do. I stole an idea from the House. You've had a CTE caucus for a very long time, and the Senate hasn't. And so with Rob Portman of Ohio and Tammy Baldwin of Wisconsin, we have created a caucus, and we've had meaningful legislation pass, both as part of WIOA and ESSA, included in those bills. And now Perkins is our priority, and the committee in the Senate is working hard on this as well. We have 3 bills that are sort of pending on the Senate side. Conceptually, I just like to describe them because I think they'd be really helpful as we look at Perkins reauthorization. First, the Educating Tomorrow's Workforce Act. I describe it in the written testimony, but it's basically trying to define for circa 2016 what is a high-quality CTE program. The interaction with the private sector and employers is important. Connection with colleges and community colleges is important. Professional development is important. So what is important about CTE education if it's going to be truly first class? And that's what the Educating Tomorrow's Workforce Act does. Second, the Middle Step Act. I've kind of viewed in my own experience and my own kids that middle school is often kind of a little bit of a pedagogical wasteland. It's kind of hormone warehouse. But if we're going to expect high schoolers to start making career choices, including CTE paths, let's use middle school to expose kids as broadly as possible to what the workforce is. Because most children, they know what their parents do and they know what teachers do, but they don't really know what's out there. Let's do that in middle school. And finally, as I conclude, the CTE Excellence and Equity Act, which is also a pilot project designed specifically to enhance CTE education in schools where there are a lot of underserved students, because it's a path to success. I'll just conclude and say this is a win-win. Employers and labor want us to do this. Governors and mayors want us to do this. CTE educators, who've often labored in the shadows but now are seeing a renaissance, they want us to do it. And most of all, our kids will win if we do. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you, Senator. Mr. Say, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Klein, Ranking Member Scott, and members of the Education and Workforce Committee, thank you for the opportunity of for being able to testify in front of you today. Thank you for calling this important hearing on the benefits and the need to fund career and technical education programs. My name is Paul Say, and I'm a proud graduate of a CTE program at Thomas Edison High School of Technology in Silver Spring. I come before you today as a staunch advocate for career development opportunities for students in construction and the skilled trades. My journey from apprentice to project manager began in Hong Kong in 1996. When I was 10 years old, my parents moved my family to America in search for a better life. We settled in Montgomery County, Maryland, and that is still where I live today. For the first 3 years of my life in America, my family bounced around rental properties and staying with relatives, simply because we just didn't have the financial means to own a home. Although my parents worked relentlessly to provide for their kids, they were not immediately able to claim their piece of the American dream. While I was attending Rockville High School, I struggled as a student. I had attendance problems, mediocre to terrible grades. I fell into the wrong crowd and lacked any type of direction. As I started my junior year, I noted my classmates and friends making plans to go off to college. As I sat and watched from the sidelines, I can still remember the feeling of embarrassment and helplessness, while those around me were beginning their climb toward success, and I sat still at the bottom. My life took a dramatic turn when my family member, who was a roofer, suggested that I look into the skilled trades as a career path. Like many of my peers, I've been pushed to attend a four-year college as if anything else was seen as settling for a failure. With the help of my guidance counselor, I found a local career and technical education program at Thomas Edison High School of Technology. Without any construction background, I nervously decided to enroll in the HVAC program my senior year. For those of you who do not know, HVAC stands for heating, ventilation, and air conditioning, which is what keeps us comfortable every single day. Spending my mornings in a typical classroom and my afternoons at Edison, I was introduced into the world of construction and the skilled trades following my industry's recognized and credentialed curriculum of National Center for Construction Education and Research, NCCER. Thanks to the dedicated staff and a newfound sense of direction, I graduated the program at the same time as my peers were graduating their typical high schools. Within a week of graduation, I had two job offers from respected local companies to join their team as an apprentice. Even before my peers packed up their bags and into their cars to head out for freshman move-in day, I accepted a position with Shapiro and Duncan Mechanical Contractors and got right to work. In the summer, I logged valuable hours as a simple helper on a small construction project, and in the fall, I started my official apprenticeship program. For the next 4 years, I worked on projects during the day and attended classroom education in the evenings at Montgomery College as part of the ACCA program, Air Conditioning Contractors of America. In the classroom, I was motivated and learned the basic theories of HVAC and also some complex math equations and calculations. My on-the-job training transferred what I had learned in the evenings into real-world projects. At the end of my program, I was proud to be named the HVAC journeyman as recognized by the state of Maryland. I'd like to note an important fact about the day I graduated. Because I was fortunate enough to have my employer pay for the cost of my apprenticeship program, I was debt-free. Not only was I debt-free, I was also paid for the four-year apprenticeship program, so I received my post-secondary education at no cost and earned 4 years of salary during that same time. I bet there are many folks in this room today, both younger and older, who are probably still paying off their student loans from undergrad or their grad school. I started my ascension into leadership positions during my time in the field. I ran small projects as a field foreman, leading small crews of 2 to 4 technicians on installation work such as AC replacements at condominiums, schools, and small office buildings. After 7 years of working in the field, I moved up the project ladder and secured a position as an assistant project manager. After a year of that, my company deemed me a valuable enough asset, and I was promoted to become a project manager. In the construction world, a project manager manages all aspects of a project, including budget, means and method of installing work, schedule, and just overall constructability. As someone who has real-world experience installing systems and welding pipe, I have a unique vantage point as a project manager. I did not only learn from the book on how to light a torch, I actually held it in my hand. Some of my colleagues graduated from four-year colleges with degrees in construction management and mechanical engineering. While I'm sure this benefited them, my field experience and CTE training gave me a true competitive edge. I come before you today humbled and thankful that I had the opportunity to attend the CTE program at Edison. It is time that students, guidance counselors, educators, parents, American public, to recognize the fulfilling and lucrative career that can be achieved in the construction and skilled trades. We must all work to remove any stigma that exists in choosing a CTE program over a traditional four-year college is somehow settling. Those 4 years I spent at Montgomery College and out in the field, I worked just as hard as the students at colleges and universities. Instead of pushing kids down the traditional path of college prep, we should be pushing kids to explore learning opportunities that prepare them for college and a career. Whether the destination is an engineering degree from the University of Maryland or a journeyman's license from the state of Maryland, high schoolers should have the equal opportunities to prepare for either pathway. Chairman Klein, Ranking Member Scott, and the members of the committee, I am the American dream. I urge all of you to ensure that every child in America has the same opportunities as I did. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Bates, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Klein, Ranking Member Scott, and members of the committee. Thank you for this opportunity to testify on this important subject. My name is Jason Bates, and I am Manager of Administration at the Toyota Bodine Plant in Jackson, Tennessee. I started working for Toyota 10 years ago, and at the plant, my responsibilities include, among other things, training and development. Last January, I was appointed by Governor Bill Haslam to serve on the Tennessee Workforce Development Board. U.S. manufacturers are depending on Congress to enact education policies that are intentional in generating a robust, world-class workforce pipeline. By taking action before the end of the year, Congress can reinvigorate the foundation required to ensure America's long-term global manufacturing leadership. Like other advanced manufacturing companies in the United States, Toyota's employment needs are significant. We face formidable challenges arising from our country's skill gap. Toyota's response to the skills gap has been both vigorous and innovative. We have partnered with over 50 schools across the country to develop benchmarked educational programs in two areas. First, we developed top service technicians for our Lexus and Toyota dealerships through a program called Toyota T10. And second, we are educating skilled manufacturing technicians for our factories through an effort called the Advanced Manufacturing Technician, or AMT program. Today, while I will focus on our AMT program, which I was responsible for launching in Tennessee with Jackson State Community College. AMT is now a core component of Toyota's manufacturing success. It is designed to supply our U.S. factories with a cadre of skilled technicians who manage and maintain complex robotics and other manufacturing equipment. The program began in 2010 as a collaboration between Toyota and Kentucky's Bluegrass Community and Technical College. Since then, it has expanded into public-private partnerships in 8 states, Alabama, Indiana, Kentucky, Mississippi, Missouri, Tennessee, Texas, and West Virginia. There are about 400 students enrolled, and that number is expected to significantly increase in the coming school year. At most of these locations, other companies, ranging from global manufacturers like 3M, GE, and Delta Faucet, to small manufacturers with fewer than 50 employees, also participate. Altogether, there are more than 160 companies involved. This is important because private sector engagement is critical to solving the skills gap, and Perkins CTE reauthorization can help foster that outcome. Classes are conducted in an environment that is set up to look, feel, and function like the work environment. Students work and attend classes 40 hours a week for 5 straight semesters and earn enough money from their work to cover their tuition and expenses. Both their study and work experiences are organized around a structured sequence that teaches various technical and employment skills. The ultimate objective is a graduate who is multi-skilled, possesses strong math and reading capabilities, is a fast technical learner, is a problem solver, a good communicator, and is comfortable working as part of a team. This is the model for a globally competitive manufacturing technician we expect that our educational partners to produce. Perkins CTE can encourage similar work-based learning opportunities which would foster similar high-caliber graduates. Critical to AMT's success is identifying qualified prospects. To ensure highly motivated students apply to the program, Toyota has increased its coordination with secondary and elementary schools. Part of our recruiting dynamic is having high school juniors, sophomores, and freshmen come and see our facilities year after year. We also interface with teachers and counselors, so they are more inclined to recommend the program to their students. Another important aspect is encouraging the right kind of learning at early stages of a student's development. Toyota maintains a close working relationship with Project Lead the Way, a nationwide program that supplies innovative science, technology, and math curricula. Other STEM partners include FIRST Robotics and VEX Robotics. Strong alignment between the manufacturing and education sector is of utmost importance to Toyota. We are thankful that the committee passed the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. Your emphasis on requiring greater business community involvement in estate workforce development decision-making is proving very helpful. As I mentioned before, I was recently appointed by Governor Haslam to serve on the Tennessee Workforce Development Board. I am honored to serve in this position and grateful that my governor believes my Toyota experience can help foster an even stronger workforce development system in our state. Aligning Perkins CTE reauthorization with WIOA would make the workforce system more efficient and easier to navigate for employers interested in lending help. Congress should reauthorize the Perkins CTE Act, and in doing so should consider the following improvements. First, align CTE programs directly with the needs of regional, state, and local labor markets in manners consistent with WIOA. Second, encourage and support meaningful collaboration between secondary, post-secondary institutions, and employers. Third, increase student participation in work-based learning opportunities. And finally, promote the use of industry-recognized credentials. Reauthorization of Perkins CTE in this manner will strengthen the workforce pipeline across America and help students succeed in industries like manufacturing. I urge this committee to take action as soon as possible. Thank you for allowing me to testify before the committee.
Thank you, sir.
To answer any questions.
Dr. Sullivan, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chair Klein. Very good. Chair Klein, Ranking Member Scott, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to be with you this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to be a part of this distinguished panel. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to share with you a few thoughts on the future of the Carl D. Perkins Career and Technical Education Act. I'm Monty Sullivan. I serve as president of Louisiana's Community and Technical Colleges. We are a system of 13 community and technical colleges serving over 150,000 students across Louisiana and providing administration and leadership for the Perkins efforts there. I'm also a member of the American Association of Community Colleges and a board member for the Rebuilding America's Middle Class, or RAMC. Reauthorization of the Perkins Act is a critical step forward for our nation, as addressing the skills gap continues to be one of the foremost challenges for igniting our economy and, more importantly, for improving the lives of Americans from all walks of life. I hail from a state with a rich career and technical education history. In fact, recently, Lumina Foundation's A Stronger Nation report indicated Louisiana's overall working age adult post-secondary attainment rate improved from 50th in the nation to 26th in the nation. A key factor in that dramatic improvement was the inclusion for the first time of less than associate degrees credentials. Louisiana ranks first in the nation in the percentage of adults with a high quality post-secondary certificate as the highest level of attainment. Not often do we get to make claims like that in Louisiana. The strategic investment of Perkins funds has been instrumental in achieving this accomplishment. This success has occurred in an environment with sharply declining state resources and increasing tuition. Meanwhile, Louisiana's economy continues to show strong workforce demands in spite of a recent downturn in the oil and gas economy. The combination of a strong market demand, narrowing state resources, and increasing tuition costs has forced our colleges to focus more keenly than ever before on responding to the workforce needs of industry, improving the value proposition to our students, and maximizing every single dollar that can be driven toward career and technical education. Simply put, alignment of programs and resources to market demands has been key to our success. The following is a list of policy recommendations for your consideration. First, align the Perkins Act with the tenets of WIOA to focus on solving the workforce challenges of states and communities. WIOA provided a foundation for data definitions and success measures that focus on regional labor market demands. Labor market data should drive investments and be a key factor in performance metrics. Specifically, in the post-secondary measures area, states with access to earnings data should be able to use that data to demonstrate their performance. And funding should be viewed as a means to underwrite programs that meet future workforce needs, not fund traditional programs. Recommendation two, emphasize regional consolidated plans across education sectors with significant industry engagement. The most successful career and technical education programs or efforts have strong partnerships and substantive industry contributions, both financial and non-financial. These partnerships should be a basic tenet of the future of Perkins. Number three, encourage dual enrollment opportunities focused on completion of high demand credentials, not simply courses. Recommendation four, under the special populations provision of the Perkins Act, consider focusing on key populations. Community colleges serve a broad cross-section of the American people. Those most in need of training are often adults with no high school diploma and returning military veterans. Consider making specific allowances for these populations within the Perkins Act. And the fifth recommendation deals with accountability. Accountability should focus on ends measures, not process means-oriented measures. Set out the purpose of the Perkins Act and measure our efforts based upon outcomes meaningful to students and communities and employers. The reauthorization of the Carl D. Perkins Act is an opportunity to target resources at one of the nation's most pressing challenges, educating and skilling our most precious natural resource, our people. The program funded through this act, the programs funded through this act are today and will be more so in the future, the path for millions of people to the American dream. I wish you the best in the work before you and look forward to answering any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks to all the witnesses. Very inspiring stories. We're going to try to move with some alacrity here, mindful of Senator Kane's need to leave a little bit early. We're going to try working with 5 minutes per member, but we may very quickly cut it to four so that everybody has a chance to participate. Let me start, Mr. Bates. In your testimony, you really talk a lot about the effectiveness of the Advanced Manufacturing Technician, the AMT program, and how it helped address Toyota's workforce challenges. But Toyota is a very large company.
Yes.
A lot of resources that smaller employers may not have, will not have by comparison. How have small businesses have been able to participate in or benefit from the AMT program?
Well, thank you, Chairman Klein. That's a wonderful question, and I can speak to my experience in Jackson, Tennessee with Jackson State Community College. Our community doesn't have a large manufacturer. Even though I work for Toyota, our plant is only about 315 team members. So most of the employers around our area are less than that. So we were able to reach out to them and ask them what their needs were. And consistently, from talking with other HR managers, they've always struggled with finding skilled technicians. And so we recognized that by them participating in this program, they would also be able to take advantage of the opportunity. One of the key success of this program is the work-based learning opportunity, the co-op program, as we call it. I myself could not sponsor or have, you know, more than two or three cohorts or more than two or three co-ops a year, and other smaller manufacturers could only maybe take one co-op a year. But by coming together, we could work with our community college to be able to support a cohort of 20 to 25 students, and that's exactly what we did. So this program is designed to allow even a small manufacturer with less than 50 employees per se be able to participate, to sponsor a co-op and have them work at their facility. And then when the student graduates after 2 years with their Associate of Applied Science degree, Not only do they have the degree, they have two years of work experience at the factory that they're co-oping. The employer has an opportunity to hire that student to come then work in their facility for their future. So it's a great opportunity to bring all sizes of manufacture together for this program.
It's a good story. Thank you very much. Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Senator Kane, you fought to expand career counseling, modernization of high schools with work-based learning opportunities, and designation of CTE as a well-rounded education component of ESSA. You also worked to get relationship skills in there that would, I assume, be very helpful as one of the soft skills we keep hearing about. What can we do to make sure that what we did in ESSA is coordinated with the CTE programs?
Thank you, Congressman Scott. It was an important part, I think, of the ESSA reauthorization this committee and the Senate did, that we did focus on the career counseling piece. You know, I think some of the testimony of the other witnesses have suggested that that's a really important part of this for teachers and counselors and students and their parents to understand how valuable these opportunities are. So I think the key that we all should focus on is now that the Department of Ed is working with the chief state school officers to implement ESSA. My wife is Secretary of Education in Virginia, is doing what 49 other secretaries are doing, pulling together the stakeholders, trying to figure out how to implement for the school year that begins in the fall of 2017. I think it's really important that we just through the Department of Ed and in our own interactions with our state officers in the states we represent, ask, what are you doing on the career counseling side? It's really important what you did by elevating CTE as kind of a core curriculum as part of the ESSA reauthorization was to end the stigma that much of the testimony discussed. But we have to make sure, as the chief state school officers are making the implementing changes, that that does actually lift to front and center. And I think that this is a really important work that we can all be about between now and the fall of 2017.
Thank you. We both work on judiciary issues and have found that CTE can be an effective strategy for keeping children engaged. How does your CTE Excellence and Equity Act help keep children engaged and reduce achievement gaps and things like that?
Very important, and I think I couldn't have had a better example than the witness who followed me. So many of our youngsters in high school who are really talented and able to do well, maybe they just don't see the relevance of what they're learning. And then they start to get into a CTE curriculum, and not only do they find that really exciting, but then the CTE curriculum reminds them why the academic subjects are strong. I've had numerous interactions with students, for example, who have decided to take CTE courses in the allied health fields, EMT. And then suddenly their biology and chemistry grades go way up because they understand what the relevance is. So the Act on CTE Excellence and Equity that we are promoting on the Senate side would be a pilot project to really go into underserved students, you know, who are not academically successful, but maybe they're not successful because they don't grasp the relevance to their future life, and do programs that provide them with student support, but also have significant connections to the private sector, to regional workforce demands, and higher ed institutions. It's that partnership, I think, that some of our students just don't know what's out there, and when they see that partnership there, they really, you know, catch fire about what their opportunities are.
The chairman and I both mentioned in opening remarks the difference between career and technical education today and what used to be an alternative to an education. Can you talk about the importance of making sure that you get the core academics as part of any CTE program?
Yeah, absolutely important. And I think, you know, as I think about my own high school years many, many years ago, vocational education was almost kind of a tracked system where people would be sort of pushed there if teachers or guidance counselors didn't think they were college material, whatever that means. We want to raise CTE, but we can't do it in a way that repeats sort of the tracking phenomenon of the past. And so I think that's why I really like this middle step bill that we have in. We have to equip students with the tools to start making choices about among competing career paths that are all great. They start to make those choices when they're signing up for high school courses, but usually They're picking high school courses without having done a lot of intentional thought about what their career options might be. Middle school isn't too early, you know, for kids to decide, do I see myself working outdoors or indoors, with people or in front of a computer? You can get kids to start thinking about what works for them. And I think we need to expand CTE, but not repeat some of the kind of tracking mistakes of the past. If we do, we'll compound our equity challenges. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Wilson, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank each of you for being here, and particularly Mr. Say. Your testimony is an encouragement to other young people to have successful lives and fulfilling lives, and so I wish you well in your career. Mr. Bates, I was particularly impressed by your description of the employer-driven training partnership you've developed. In South Carolina, we've attracted many blue-chip companies, such as Boeing, because of the ability to create skilled talent with advanced career and technical education workers through employer-driven training partnerships such as the ones you described. A great example is the Boeing Ready SC partnership. This program has resulted in hiring of over 4,500 program graduates since its founding in 2009. South Carolina was able to go from a state that did not have a significant aviation industry into one that's producing the world's most advanced wide-body aircraft, the 787 Dreamliner, with 8,000 employees and obviously suppliers across the state. This is why the programs I would like to see encouraged in the reauthorization of the Perkins Career and Technical Education Act. Could you speak to the emphasis that employers are placing on the availability of talent deciding where they're to locate their major operations?
Yes, Congressman. I think that's very important. In my community, the Economic and Community Development Group is very active in reaching out to global manufacturers to come relocate to our area. And I think many states are the same way. And I can testify that the our AMT program that we established at Jackson State Community College was a determining factor for a recent manufacturer to come to our state and set up their manufacturing operation. They're an automotive supplier, and that was one of the decision makers for them, that they knew that they had a workforce development program at a local community college that was going to be able to provide them with the skilled technicians that they were going to need not only now but also in the future. So these types of programs are absolutely essential for our continued growth and developing our global manufacturing leadership here in the United States.
And I want to congratulate Tennessee. Dr. Rowe has educated us on the success of Tennessee. And then from the perspective of South Carolina, we're very grateful that with the success of a sister company, BMW,
yes.
We're grateful that, amazingly enough, we're the largest exporter of cars of any state in the union. And then, again, Mr. Say, we still have room for you in South Carolina. We have tire manufacturing. Who would imagine South Carolina is now the leading manufacturer and exporter of tires, with Bridgestone of Japan, with Michelin of France, with the Continental of Germany, Giddy Tire of Singapore. So, again, it's technical education that's made a difference. And Dr. Sullivan, in your testimony today, about creating jobs, I'm really grateful that, as I cited in South Carolina, we've had terrific programs like the Apprenticeship Carolina, the SC Technical College System. And with that, in your background, what would you identify as the biggest challenges facing schools and businesses to partner to improve the CTE programs?
Thank you for the question, Congressman Wilson, and certainly the state of South Carolina has offered up a great deal for many of us to learn from, and we're appreciative for the good work going on there. One of the things that I think is most important for us to do as community and technical colleges is to remain both aware of and keep pace with industry demands in terms of the workforce needs. Oftentimes that can be a difficult challenge because of the resource limitations. Perkins provides a critical opportunity for us to be able to make those investments to remain competitive in terms of the curriculum that we offer. One of the second areas that's very difficult for our colleges to keep up with is to ensure that our faculty members have the training necessary to be relevant in the classroom for students. And that relationship back with business and industry, just as we talked about a few minutes ago, is so very important because industry oftentimes can help us to not only know where they may be today, but also to forecast where they're going in the future.
And I want to commend Virginia for its success, but one of the reasons we had success, it goes to the equipment, is a company could locate their manufacturing equipment in a technical school and reserve their proprietary information, and persons could be trained so that immediately when the facility is completed, a young person like Mr. Say can go right to work and be very productive. I yield the balance of my time.
Thank the gentleman. We were starting to run out of states, I think. I'm not sure. I feel slighted, by the way. Ms. Futt, you're recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today. It was enlightening to hear of your success stories and as well to hear our chairman talk about the need for these programs now more than ever. And with that said, I do have to note that Perkins funding has declined by 24% since 1998. So if we need these programs, certainly we need to take a look at how we fund them. Senator, can you just talk to me about how this reduction in funds has hindered the expansion of high-quality CTE programs?
The reduction of funds is sort of coming at exactly the wrong time, because good news is I think there's a renaissance of awareness that this is really important. And with the economic circumstances of especially the fiscal reversals and recession of 2008, 2010, there's even more need for training and more need for people to receive that training. So the funding has been going down at the same time as the need has been increasing, and thank goodness we've all been realizing the importance of these programs. So you get good bang for the buck out of these investments.
And I just want to say, as we all fly a lot, I was sitting on a plane one day next to a guy, and this is in the last month, who probably had the dirtiest fingernails I've ever seen in my life, right? So I asked him what he does. He teaches welding to young people at a high school in Texas. He started to talk to me about how important Perkins was. He started to talk to me about what these young people have accomplished through his programs and how they have succeeded when no one thought they would succeed. So I agree 100%. We need to look at the funding, and we need to fund more of these programs so these young people can come out and do productive things. We know that there's a shortage of welders in this country, of bricklayers and masons. We need to train them, and I think that we can do that if we put the resources in it. So I thank you for that. As well to you, Senator Kaine, last year I introduced the Go to High School, Go to College Act, which would expand Pell eligibility, of course, for students attending early college high schools. Mm-hmm. You introduced the Jobs Act last year as well, which would allow Pell grants to students enrolled in short-term job training programs. Can you talk a bit about why it's important for us to expand the use of Pell grants to these kinds of programs?
Okay, I'll get on my soapbox. This is really important. This is an example of the second-class status of CTE that still is kind of contained in the federal laws. So Pell Grant, if you income qualify, you can get a Pell Grant, but the course has to be the length of a college semester. A lot of high-intensity welding programs are 10-week courses. It's not the length of a college semester. It's not 14 weeks. So we don't allow Pell Grants for these intense CTE programs. Why don't we? I mean, the student income qualifies. It's because we have viewed those programs as second class. I'll tell you another one. In the military, active duty, military tuition assistance benefit. You can get that if your CO says what you want to study is relevant to your MOS. You can use it at a community college or a college, up to $4,500 a year. But if you want to use $300 to take the American Welding Society certification exam because you're trained as an ordnance enlisted or officer, you can't use the money for the certification exam. You've got to use it on a college campus. It makes no sense. There are still many policies that kind of hold the college and CTE on two levels. And some of the best policy we can do is going through and removing those vestiges of the day when CTE was not viewed as of equal measure. And that's why we introduced the Jobs Act. So if you income qualify, take that 10-week HVAC intensive course. It doesn't have to be the length of a college semester.
Well, certainly I'm hopeful that that is something we can do on a bipartisan basis. It makes all the sense in the world. So I'm hoping that my colleagues will be supportive of it. Lastly to you, Senator Kaine, please talk to me about why it is important for us to address the Higher Education Act as it relates to training educators in these CTE programs.
Great question. The Higher Education Act is also maybe the best place to to fix this Pell Grant disparity that we were just discussing. But training is critical. One of the bills that we have that I was discussing in my testimony, the Educating Tomorrow's Workforce Act, really talks about this career training and professionalism. I think we've all seen many of our great teachers these days are career switchers, but there is no place where that is more the case than in CTE education. And I'm sure that the teacher that you talked to on the train, on the plane with the dirty fingernails, before he was a teacher, he was a practicing welder, and then he was bringing that into the classroom. So professional development is really important, and maybe with a special focus on the career switcher to bring them from the technical field into the classroom. They tend to be the most popular teachers in many of the schools where they work.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The lady yields back. Senator Kaine, it's not my role to be your staffer, but I understand that we've reached your hard stop, and I want to thank you again for your time and your expertise, and wish you good luck in turning that slide around. Jesuits still need you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate the committee members.
Thank you very much, Senator. Dr. Fox, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. While Senator Kaine's leaving, I want to say how much I appreciated his comments, in particular his experiences with seeing people who feel going into education that is not a four-year degree is something less than a four-year degree. I've experienced that myself, and as far as I know, everybody getting a four-year degree wants a vocation. Therefore, as my attitude is, all education is vocational education, because everybody's out there wanting to get a job when they complete their credential. So might keep that in mind as something to talk about. Mr. Bates, you recommended we consider ways to increase work-based learning as part of the Perkins Act reauthorization. I think we can all agree that work-based learning is important and it benefits students. If you want to say more about that, okay, but I think we get that. But tell me what Toyota did to get the schools on board with this idea, because that is usually a big hurdle to face.
Yes, that is a good question, Congresswoman. One of the things that we had to do when we first were looking into this program is we had to be very honest with the schools. The community college came to our facility and were asking us how they were doing. And we had to tell them, unfortunately, the graduates and the students that they were producing were not meeting our qualifications. And that was measured through a pre-employment test, skills test, technical test that the graduates had to take. We had a 25% pass rate, which is not very good. And so they were very willing to hear and take that knowledge, and we share with them the AMT program that Toyota had utilized in Kentucky, and they then went out of their way and visited the communities, colleges in Kentucky. They went to Mississippi, and they saw the value of this program, and they also saw and recognized the value of cooperative work experiences. And I think that experience allowed them to then realize the benefit of it. The other benefit that we had locally is that one of the directors of the program had gone through many, many years ago a tool and die journeyman's apprenticeship. And he was able to then also realize the value of his work experience in getting to where he was in his career. So those types of experiences and reminding the schools that their job is to help produce students who can find employment. And the best way to do that is to provide them an education and also provide them with an opportunity to apply that education and develop that skill.
I've talked with Toyota people about the T10 program and about how you involve smaller employers in your program too. And I want to commend Toyota for having the perspective that it's important to help people get a good education throughout the community, because you share these people back and forth. I'm a big proponent, as my colleagues know, of apprenticeships, internships, on the job. But I understand that Toyota has not registered the AMT program with the Department of Labor. Can you discuss the reasons you opted not to register the program?
I think I can answer that question simply as logistics. The AMT program is not just a program that Toyota is doing it by itself. We are really dependent upon the school to provide the curriculum and the training. We have over 160 other companies that are part of the program in a variety of different states. And to coordinate What that would require to get it federally recognized would be a very difficult endeavor. I would say, however, in my understanding of federal recognized apprentice programs, what we have would meet the qualifications for that program.
Thank you very much. Mr. Say, at what age do you think schools should start exposing students to career exploration and CTE learning opportunities?
Congresswoman, I personally feel that the earlier the better. I think they should, or kids should generally get to make their own choices. They should be able to explore what's right for them as early as possible. As Senator Kane mentioned earlier, I think middle school would be a great starting point for kids to look at different paths they want to take in life.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, just one quick comment about the comments about the 25% pass rate. It does us no good to keep throwing money at these programs if we don't have accountability and they aren't producing what it is we need. So I think this hearing is great at telling us how we need to reform the programs to get what we need for the money we're paying.
Gentlelady's time has expired. Ms. Bonamici.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Ranking Member, I'm very glad we're having this discussion today about how to strengthen the Perkins Career and Technical Education Act. It's something that comes up at almost every single high school I visit. In St. Helens, Oregon, which is a town of about 13,000 people in rural Columbia County, there's a view of Mount St. Helens. That's where the town's name came from. They have five different CTE programs, all of which serve the community. They have an early childhood education program that runs a daycare center. They have the they're the only high school in Oregon that has a AAA certified auto repair shop. And when I met with the instructor, he said, "We don't teach students how to repair cars. I teach them business ethics. There's so many lessons there." Their construction students build tiny homes, which is a kind of a win-win for communities that have housing challenges. And I've seen so many students who are engaged because of the availability of these classes. Sherwood High School in my district has a girls-only welding class. It's always full with a wait list. Newburgh High School has a fabulous culinary program where students are learning chemistry and science as well as culinary skills. One of the things I want to emphasize, though, we all know about the skills gap, and there's so many examples of CTE courses that are designed to really meet the local needs. Another example from my district is Yamhill Carlton High School in Yamhill County, in partnership with Chemeketa Community College. They have viticulture programs to teach people how to work in the wine industry, which is a big part of the economy there. It's the only high school I know of with a vineyard. But they're teaching students the skills they need for those local jobs. But as Senator Kane mentioned, oftentimes these CTE classes inspire students to do well in their other courses as well. And I'm concerned if we're in a situation where we're denying opportunities to students to experience CTE courses just because there may not be jobs available in that particular area. Because students are learning important skills like collaboration, communication, responsibility, as well as academics. So I would have concern if we're only giving these opportunities to students if there are jobs that match up in the local community at that period of time. This is education. We need to make sure that students are having skills for the jobs of tomorrow that we might not even know about as well as the jobs of today. So I'm sure I speak for all of my colleagues when I say I hope we can reauthorize Perkins and provide states and educators with the direction and resources they need. I know that both Ms. Fox and Mr. Wilson talked about the work-based programs. Boeing in Oregon, for example, has an internship program and they pay students to learn. Some of them go on to take positions with Boeing. Many go to other similar manufacturing companies or go to apprenticeship programs that are operated jointly by Boeing and the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers. So I wonder if maybe you could discuss maybe Mr. Bates briefly, because I want time for another question. How are those work-based learning opportunities, how can we expand those, but particularly with focus on some of the rural areas?
Yes, I think that's an excellent question, and that's a struggle in my state as well. In Tennessee, we have a large rural population that struggles to have those opportunities. I think one of the things that's very helpful is the community college system in my area does reach out to over I think it's a 10-county area, and most of them are rural counties. And one of the things that we've done is reach out to all the various high schools in those counties and educate them about the programs that were available around this CTE-type programs. We have visited high schools, and we have taught them about the value of, in our area, the value of manufacturing and the skills that is necessary to learn and be able to be effective in manufacturing. One of the things that's important is to also help them recognize that if we are able to provide them with good job opportunities, provide them with a great education, that their time in learning those skills are going to be beneficial to them in the long run.
Terrific. And I do, just in the remaining few seconds, want each of you to just talk about the importance of evidence-based practices. And we need to have ongoing research that will help identify proven strategies. Any thoughts on how important that is to make sure that we're engaging all students in proven programs? Anybody want to weigh in?
Perhaps I'll begin. You know, I think career and technical education is a natural fit for evidence-based practice. There are lots of examples out there, not only of exactly the skill sets that are needed within the curriculum, but also the outcomes. Employers, as we talk to employers across Louisiana, have said to us, show me a quality program and we'll show you graduates that are making a great income. And so the evidence not only is happening within the curriculum as well as within the earnings side of things as well.
I see my time has expired. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the lady for yielding back. Dr. Rowe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Say, I can do a very sophisticated operation on your wife or your family, but my air conditioning doesn't work on the third floor of my house right now. I need you in Tennessee. We're not a wealthy state in Tennessee, and we don't have a state income tax, but we have the lowest per capita debt in the nation. We have had the largest education gains in the country for 3 years in a row. We had the second fastest job growth. We have no road debt, so we're a very well-run and managed state, and yet we recognized in our state that career technical education was incredibly important. We're the only state in the union that provides free community college and technical education. If you leave the workforce, let's say you lose your job, something happened to your job where you were, there's a program called Tennessee Reconnect, and you can come back in and be retrained. And this was something we recognized for the future of our state. Probably it won't pay dividends for 10, 15, 20 years, but Tennessee is investing heavily in CTE education. And one of the things that I want to get to fairly quickly, and by the way, just another comment, during the height of the recession, 90% of the people graduating from our technical schools got jobs during the height of the recession when other people were looking for jobs everywhere. So there is a huge need for what you're doing, and I totally support it. What I want to do is, if Tennessee can do this and make this investment, and we have like the fourth or fifth lowest per capita income in the country, why can't other states do it? And what I want to know is, how do we streamline this? And Dr. Sullivan, you touched on it in your comments about the four or five things we could do. How can we make this money go further?
Thank you for your question. And I think probably the beginning point is to have consolidated plans across educational sectors. The notion of having a local application plan for a secondary school system and a separate plan for post-secondary education, both of whom are probably trying to engage with employers separately, is a non-starter. It really isn't a very efficient use of the dollar. When we begin to think about it, we have to think about the act more so turning the telescope around from the other end and begin to think of it from the labor market perspective and the employer perspective rather than from the educational entity perspective. I think that's a big shift in our thinking.
And that's how you would coordinate the WIOA that we did, I guess, a couple of years ago. And,
yes, sir.
And Mr. Bates, one of the things I wanted to ask was that basically what you all did at Toyota was private sector driven. You had to get skilled technicians to work in your plant in Jackson, Tennessee, or otherwise you couldn't be competitive in the world.
That's correct.
So you reached out to the technical schools, private sector reached out to the public sector, and you worked together to try to create this this opportunity, not only for students, but for job creation. Am I correct?
Yes.
And is that the way we should be going? See, I believe this top-down approach we do here, where we try to tell you what to do, is the wrong way. I believe the bottom-end approach, where you all are on the ground working every day, you know what your needs are. One of the things we haven't mentioned, and in a bipartisan way we did worked on this last week, is one of the things I hear at home all the time is, can you pass a drug test? Something as simple as that. Can you just pass a drug test? Will you show up to work on time? Those are soft skills, I realize, but those are just as important as the other technical skills that you're learning. One other question I have is, as the committee looks into this reauthorization of Perkins, what reforms should we consider to allow states to meet their unique educational business needs? What should we do?
What should we do? Well, I think it's important to reach out to the local industry to find out what specifically is necessary. I have to give credit to Governor Haslam in the state of Tennessee. Many years ago, or about 4 or 5 years ago, he went through the entire state and had roundtables with educators, with local industry, and had discussions. What is it that we need to provide? And in our community, it was, we need assistance with helping to provide for the skilled training, for the skilled technicians for our future workforce. And he was able then to take that information from across the state and develop various programs that allow us to have things like you mentioned, Tennessee Reconnect, the Tennessee Promise, which encourages young people to look at technical education and community colleges as a way to get that technical education for their future.
And many people, has been pointed out, will just use that as a stepping stone to then go further their education in something else, as Mr. Say did. One final comment. I think one of the frustrations I have in this place is we have an overtime rule that's going to come out this week. The University of Tennessee, one of my alma maters, it's going to, that complying with that one rule, just not a law but a rule, is going to add 4% to the tuition of every student that goes to the University of Tennessee, whereas one of the biggest barriers to education today is cost. Vanderbilt University, complying with all the rules and regulations they have to do, costs them $150 million to comply with government rules and regulations. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman yields back. Mr. Pocan, recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it, and thank you to the witnesses. You know, I get a chance to visit a number of our technical schools, not only in our state, but even in other states, and one of the things they always point out is the value of the Perkins money, and they show me what they've used it for and how many people it's helping, and that's really appreciated. In fact, just last week I was at Gateway Technical College, and they had a group of children, a couple busloads of children, doing sumo wrestling robots they were making in the high school and middle school level to get the interest, and it was great watching the energy and the participation on that. I do want to echo, I think, Ms. Fudge's, though, request about, you know, why it is still very important that we look at the funding, because, you know, I've seen the funding in practical application in these facilities. I'd like to get to three areas. The first one, Mr. Bates, one of your suggestions you talked about, I think it was your third point, was about more student participation. I was hoping you could just expand on that a little bit and also talk about teacher participation, because I think, as Senator Kane just started mentioning a little bit, we need that pipeline of those teachers, especially people entering mid-career, but often they don't have a lot of say in the Perkins program directly. Could you just address that point you were talking about and maybe add it about teachers?
Yeah, teacher involvement is absolutely critical. One of the things that we've done at our facility is that we've reached out to teachers and expose them to what today's manufacturing is. And in fact, while we have students come in and they walk through our plant and they're very they're bright-eyed and they're excited about the technology that we have, I've always found the facial expressions of the teachers much more entertaining, because they cannot believe the amount of technology that we have. We have robotics that are moving pieces of product. We have a lot of automation that's moving things back and forth, and they can't believe that manufacturing is the way it is today. So that exposure to a teacher is extremely important. We've offered summer externships for teachers to come and work in our plant for the summer, so that they, whether they're a math teacher, whether they're a science teacher, we've even had English teachers come and work in Toyota facilities to learn what it's like to work in manufacturing, so that they can then go back to their students and talk about how what they're teaching applies in the real world. So that exposure and giving teachers that opportunity to see what manufacturing is absolutely critical in their further education and understanding.
Great, thank you. Dr. Sullivan, a question. I had listing sessions last week in district, and someone came and talked to me about specifically the question, and I was hoping you might be able to address this, or if you know some best practices. We have a lot of people who are actually doing gaming in our area. It's one of our three kind of growing industries, and they said that Perkins isn't always available for that, and sometimes they're afraid that some of the things we might be teaching with Perkins might be things that might be a little bit maybe antiquated in a few years. Could you just address that a little bit, just because I'd like to be able to get back to my constituent?
Sure. Thank you for the question. This is one of the areas where I think we need to aim the Perkins resource at those efforts that are emerging markets. And sometimes that puts you on the bleeding edge rather than the cutting edge. And so I think you have to be careful that the investment is being made in an area that is going to pay off for your communities, for your schools, for your colleges. But imagine for a second the critical thinking that goes on in some of the gaming programming areas. There's certainly a benefit to the student. And if you can demonstrate that it's an emerging market, I think it makes sense to be able to make those investments.
Thank you. And then just a general question I'd like to open up for anyone in the remaining minute and a half is just the point that Senator Kaine brought up about a stigma surrounding CTE sometimes in our society. You know, I have Madison, Wisconsin in my district. I've heard stories where people are picked up in cabs from the airport by people with PhDs in Russian literature, but I have a buddy who got a technical degree and working on safety and construction sites, and he is doing extremely well for himself in just a short amount of time coming out of technical college. Can you address that a little bit, some ideas about how we could help work on that issue?
You know, I think that we have to begin with the notion that there's a great deal of math and science that goes on for that welding faculty member. Imagine for a second the geometry, as an example, that goes into angles as someone begins to think about how to apply two pieces of metal together, the chemistry behind it. We have a mindset, I think, that has to be broken to begin to think about the academic side of what goes on in career and technical education. The other side we mentioned a second ago with critical thinking. There simply is not an area of education, more so than career and technical education, where critical thinking is important.
Anyone else want to address that?
Yeah, I think that the stigma is unfortunately there, but what we can do is help to educate what career and technical education is. The science and the math that our technicians are utilizing to program the robots, to troubleshoot the robots, that is engineering work that's being done. So it is not what people think of career and technical education today.
Thank you. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Mr. Wahlberg.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to the witnesses for being here today, and your testimonies have been instructive. And I just want to thank my colleague, Dr. Rowe, for bringing up the overtime rule. We're talking about making value and using our resources wisely for training, especially in CTE, and yet we find ourselves siphoning off more opportunities as a result of wrong-headed regulatory impingements on the system working. And appreciate you bringing it up. Dr. Sullivan, I've talked with a number of employers, including Toyota, in my district, who have told me they don't believe that students are presented with a full picture of their educational and career options. You've pointed out some things about teachers coming through site visits and being amazed with what they're seeing, and maybe that's one of the key concerns. As a result, they find it difficult to encourage students to pursue CTE careers that are amazingly diverse. As I've walked through manufacturing sites and small businesses and large alike, diverse career field, financially rewarding, fulfilling, and in fact, some jobs that will never leave. They're there, and if a person is willing to climb an energy pole or to work on a roof, or to work in a basement, build a construction, machinist, tool and die makers, welders, I just go on and on of areas that are amazing with their opportunity. What role should career guidance and career awareness activities play in promoting the value of CTE programs and ultimately fulfilling careers?
Sure. Well, career guidance is certainly a critical component, but I think it begins even before that. It is so very important to have industry engaged from the very beginning. Classic examples recently, just yesterday, in fact, J.P. Morgan Chase announced an investment in the city of New Orleans. I was at Warren Easton High School for the New Skills for Youth initiative, where J.P. Morgan Chase sees an opportunity to invest in the people because there are specific outcomes that they are looking for. It is indeed an investment, not a gift. And so having those students exposed to local industry early on, be it middle school, as was pointed out a few minutes ago, I think it's important that we not lay that burden upon counselors only. It's important that counselors have partners in business and industry from the beginning that not only informs where a student may go, but it also informs the curriculum, it informs the equipment, it informs the teaching the background that individual faculty should have, but it also ultimately leads then so that students begin to think of our institutions and our programs as an entree into a specific industry. And that is a that's a view that I'm not sure that many students have today, but we certainly have to begin to change that direction. I think as you have industry involved with those counselors, they have a much better opportunity then to tell the story of the career path.
How do we, and you bring up a great point there, of that comradeship of industry with education, but we also have the challenge of the peer pressure that I'm seeing from parents who think that Billy and Susie down the street went to University of Michigan. So my Tommy and Nancy have to go there as well, as opposed to seeing the unbelievable opportunities that are expanded beyond that, not just simply with a four-year institution, but sometimes the stacking of certificates that lead to a graded. How do we deal with that?
You know, you're absolutely correct, and I'll give you one example. As Chancellor Delgado Community College, we would point to our allied health programs, where more than one half of the students graduating from those healthcare programs already held a baccalaureate degree. These are students going back to college to earn a credential that would ensure that they were able to go to work. And so over time, I think enough graduates living in basements will help us as a nation to understand that perhaps alignment of curriculum and alignment of programs, the work that has gone on by Tony Carnevale and the folks at Georgetown really sort of aims us at major matters. How much you earn is directly related to what skills you have. And as a nation, I think ultimately we will get there, but we're certainly not moving as quickly as we should.
Okay. Mr. Bates, as the committee looks to reform and improve this law, how can we streamline programs to ensure federal dollars enable students to develop the right skills to meet the 21st century needs?
Well, again, I think it's important that we have involvement with education and industry leaders to talk about what are those skills, so that we are targeting that funding to the appropriate skills that are going to not only supply the skilled workforce for today, but it's industry that understands what the technology is going to be in the future. And by sharing that knowledge with the educational partners, we're able to make sure that the curriculum is established that's going to fund the future training needs as well.
Thank you. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Mr. Takano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I certainly want to push back a little bit on the overtime rule. I want to just mention that in 1975, over 65% of salaried workers in America were entitled to overtime pay. Today, that percentage of the workforce is down to 8%. It's high time that we updated the overtime rule, and I'm very, very eager to see what the president does today. Mr. Shea, I want to just congratulate you on your very brave and courageous path. Especially as an Asian American young man, there's a tremendous amount of pressure for us to succeed in higher education. I know that you must have suffered mightily from expectations of your family, but you are such a great example to so many Asian American young men and women across the country to show that not everybody has to go to college to succeed. And indeed, I think you probably have got stackable credentials that you can, you probably have already got plans, or if you have not already done so, getting your degrees in higher ed. But you've made a remarkable path, and you've shown people that way. So, and we need to destigmatize the pathway for all minorities because of the past reputation of how vocational education was a dumping ground and a way to put people who were quote-unquote not qualified for college into programs that didn't serve them well. So we need to redo the image of career and technical education for all Americans, and you certainly serve as a great example for that. So I want to just take a moment to say that. Dr. Sullivan, yesterday the Department of Education announced that the Obama administration would make Pell Grants available to high school students who simultaneously take college courses at 44 colleges or universities. How can we encourage dual enrollment opportunities, and how does Louisiana Community and Technical College System foster those opportunities in the context of our discussion today?
Sure. Thank you for your question. Dual enrollment is an absolutely critical strategy to solving the nation's attainment issue. The skills gap, the dual enrollment effort needs to be focused, however, not just simply on completion of courses, but rather on completion of credentials, and those demand credentials matter. Dual enrollment has been a strategy and a focus for us in Louisiana for a number of years now, and I can tell you that the career and technical education side has a particular bent for those students who may not perform well in the academic areas, simply out of interest as much as anything. But we're also seeing a large number of minority students who are enrolling in those career and technical education fields via dual enrollment. We're seeing those students complete credentials and benefit going forward. One of the changes that has happened for us as a nation, I believe, in higher education is education is now becoming much more iterative in nature. We talk about stackable credentials. Many of these students are completing their first credential, going out into the world of work, and then being able to gain those certifications. I talked about, we heard it earlier from one of my fellow witnesses here about the ability to come back and gain some certification that allows you to go to that next level. So the dual enrollment certainly feeds into that that iterative nature as well. But funding for dual enrollment is an absolutely key strategy for us as a nation.
Thank you. Thank you. And I'm very focused on that area of trying to make that happen, make our federal funding, whether it's Pell Grants or whatever, or the state grants that go into this. These funding streams for dual enrollment are important. We need to be able to give you the pots of money to reduce the class size, because it's expensive education as well. I want to make sure I throw out a call out to Toyota and Mr. Bates. Remarkable stuff you're doing with the AMT program, which is really a word maintenance, right? It's maintaining these machines, but it's not the maintenance of our Father's or Grandfather's Day or sweeping floors, maintaining the place. This is about maintaining robots and mm-hmm. fixing robots.
Yes.
And there was no federal money involved in this. This was driven by a partnership. And I want to congratulate you for working with the community college system and that community college system for working with you.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I wouldn't say there wasn't any federal dollars. The community college was able to use some prior Perkins money to be able to provide for some of the equipment and the training that was necessary for the instructors.
Thank you for clarifying that. So there was some federal.
Yes.
So there was some. Mr. Say, I want to just quickly before my time runs out. I see that as low as fifth grade, students have a self-awareness of whether they're good with their hands or not, and things like that. And I would take it back from middle school all the way down to fifth grade as far as what we do to reach younger people.
The gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank the panel for this has been a very good discussion. You know, when it comes to reauthorizing programs, at least everywhere I go in my district and really the state and across the country, people ask me, when are y'all going to quit spending so much money? When are you going to balance your budget? And that makes the reauthorization of these programs very difficult, and that's why we're here today to try to determine, you know, where we can get the best bang for the dollars we invest, and that's what the American people expect of us. Obviously, one of the things that we have to do is grow this economy and get people back to work, able-bodied people back to work. That will help us with our mandatory spending problem. It will reduce that, which will lead to balancing this budget. As a business, member of the business community, I am committed to growing the economy, and I know that you have to invest money to get a return, to grow revenues, and in fact, that's why I ran for the United States Congress. As far as the thing that I see, at least with education and developing a skilled workforce, is motivation. How do we motivate young people to want to go and get the training and to get a good job, to provide? I mean, one of the greatest gifts God has given me is to give people that opportunity to get a good job, to give them dignity and respect they deserve, and to allow them to support their family, their church, their community, and this nation. So, Mr. Say, you obviously were motivated, and I would just like, from your personal testimony, what clicked in you that said, hey, this is what I want to do, And of course, obviously, you've been very successful. And then how can we apply that to those in the field who are experts to make sure that every student, everyone gets that opportunity and makes the best of the opportunities you have?
Thank you for that question, Congressman. I personally feel, for me at least, in my personal experience, was the gratification of seeing something being built. Instead of just looking through a textbook of, you know, why you need to do something a certain way, it was actually a realization of, hey, if I do this one way, it's going to take me longer and it's more difficult to do this one way versus, you know, doing this other way, which is just, I'll call it the smarter way. May not be the easier way, but it's a smarter way of doing certain things. And I think that's what I needed. That was the drive, or that was the little push that I needed in high school to realize that, hey, college isn't the only thing out there for you. Like, I may not be super good at getting good grades and reading out of a textbook and learning that way, but I can certainly learn with my hands and being able to do something like physically with my body. I think that seeing something built is one of the greatest encouragements.
Yeah. Yeah, I worked my way through college as a welder, so I always still enjoy that, but was a general contractor in my business life. So I too like to build buildings and understand, interest and the challenges it presents. Obviously, HVAC work has come a long way since it's very sophisticated this day and time. As far as the CTE programs, students with the skills needed in these high-demand jobs, Mr. Bates, as far as students earning these industry-recognized credentials and students completing their programs to enter the workforce, what are the biggest obstacles that you see?
I think the biggest obstacles, Congressman, is again perception and awareness. Many students, for whatever reason, aren't aware of what's required to work in today's manufacturing business. They make a wrong assumption that I have to get an engineering degree in order to be successful. And what we've been able to do by reaching out to these schools and educating teachers, counselors, and students is to help them understand that they do need technical training. They do need a technical skill, but you can accomplish that debt-free. You can accomplish that locally and by participating at your local technical school or community college. And I think by educating them and helping them to understand what is available to them, they'll make the right choice for them because they know it's available.
Well, good. Well, thank you so much, and I yield back the remainder of my
gentleman yields back. Ms. Clark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the panelists for being here today on this incredibly important topic. In Massachusetts, I just wanted to give you a little snapshot. In the 2014-15 school year, we had 2,800 culinary arts students, 2,700 health assistants, 2,200 automotive technology, 2,000 studying electricity, 1,900 carpentry, 1,700 cosmetology, 1,500 marketing, and 1,400 in early education and care, with a wait list of 5,000 high school students who could not find an entry point. We have a recent study out by Northeastern University finding that Massachusetts business owners find our Voc Tech school graduates to be more job ready than their peers who went through college prep programs. So we know how vital this is, not only to our students, but to our economy. And one of my questions is, as we look at some of our European counterparts, in particular Switzerland, Germany, Austria, we see these robust apprenticeship programs that we've touched on a little bit. Senator Kaine has offered some legislation that would give tax credits for businesses and employers who are establishing apprenticeship positions. Are there other things you think we should be doing or policies to further the robust public-private partnerships that you've already discussed?
Thank you for your question, and certainly apprenticeship is a key strategy in the overall effort. I will tell you that most recently in some work with Dow Chemical, our Louisiana Community Technical College systems have really formalized the apprenticeship effort. One of the things we've learned through that process is not only the value of apprenticeship, as we have known that for a number of years, but also the need to sort of streamline the processes for approval. And I think that was referenced earlier in some testimony. So that's one of the areas that I would really encourage us to think of. How do we create apprenticeship programs, approval processes, and funding opportunities that are in a much more streamlined kind of approach? The other portion of this is apprenticeship is a formalized way for us to develop an industry relationship that we probably should have had anyway. And so there's an important element or underlying factor there of business and industry relationship.
And Mr. Say, do you believe that the apprenticeship also has a component that could help reduce some of the residual stigma that we're seeing? Do you think that's an important piece, that if people are able to see the jobs and the opportunities sooner and in a more concrete way?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel that the quicker the students are able, or the younger people are able to see that these job openings are out there and that they can streamline their way directly from school into employment, I think that's more encouragement for them to go through these programs. I think the quicker we can show them that, it's kind of like the light at the end of the tunnel. As soon as we can show them, then it's more likely they would be able to succeed in those programs and enroll even.
Great. My other question, the Perkins CTE Act also provides supports for special populations, and there is a long list, but including individuals with disabilities, low income, pursuing non-traditional career paths, single parents, displaced homemakers, and English language learners. Of the people who come through your doors, either as trainees or recently trained employees, how many do you think fit this special population definition? And can you tell me about some of the support services for these students? Particularly, I have in mind single parents. We see childcare as an incredible cost for families to bear, and I wondered if any of you had experience in that area in particular.
You know, the American Community College is typically about two-thirds female. Typically, many of those female students are single mothers. And so what we traditionally see as we look at the special populations are a great deal of additional services needed for childcare, as you pointed out, for also different kinds of accommodations. But I think as we consider special populations, really important that we not leave out the American citizen who, for whatever reason, was not able to earn a high school diploma. Most students do not drop out of high school as a result of academic issues. They drop out of high school for social and personal reasons. Where do they turn if they don't have that opportunity to be trained and educated so that they can pursue a happy life? The American dream as we know it. So I would just encourage us to think about expanding that definition. The second group, certainly there are a great number of benefits that are available to returning veterans, but I really think it's important that we consider returning veterans as a component of that special populations. And also to sort of get out of the mindset that special populations are the traditional definition that has been in the Perkins Act, and expanding the possibilities for roles or areas where perhaps some of our more traditional students have not been represented as greatly as perhaps they have in the past.
Thank you. I see my time has expired.
Gentlelady yields back. Mr. Rakita.
I thank the chairman for the hearing. I appreciate everyone's testimony. I was going to start last with this, but Dr. Sullivan, since you mentioned pursuing a happy life, i.e. the pursuit of happiness, let me start there. What concerns me most about career and technical education, by the way, I'm a supporter. We've had the subcommittee that I lead, we have hearings around it and all that, but my last direct interaction with career and technical education was back in the 80s. And from then till now, I worried about the ability to critically think and if that's being taught, right? If you're gonna run a free republic, we can't have automatons. We need engaged citizenry who can question their government, decipher the role between government and the individual, the federal government and state government, and on and on and on. And I'm not talking about partisan politics. I'm not even talking about civics courses. The ability to critically engage and think in order to maintain a free society. How does CTE programs do that in the here and now?
Thank you for your question. I think that is an absolutely vital part of the whole career and technical education landscape. If you were to look across the industry-based certifications that are approved out there that in any given field, I think you will find woven in every single one of those industry-based credentials a component of critical thinking. It is the foundation of nearly every aspect, be it manufacturing, be it HVAC, construction, nearly any of the fields you can think of, even the medical fields. One of the most important facets of teaching any of the medical programs is that ability to critically think about what is going on with our patients.
Right. So, does it translate into the broader social?
There's no question it translates into the broader social, and also the thing that I think is really important is that it provides a foundation upon which these students can continue their education and pursue advanced degrees. That ability to critically think, our faculty say this to us regularly. They come to us and say, a student who has already earned college credit and earned a credential and has been out in the workforce and understands the issues of day-to-day interactions and problem solving is a better student in the classroom.
So that's my follow-up to Mr. Say. I mean, I call these on-ramps and off-ramps, this idea that you might start out in HVAC technical ed, but what if underneath it all, you really are the guy to own your own HVAC company? What if you really are, after all, the entrepreneur and you want to pursue those skills? Were you worried at all, or do you think that career and technical education could cut off something so you don't have an on-ramp back to a more traditional education or path that would lead you to be an owner or a project manager like yourself or something like that?
I was a little concerned at first when I was initially enrolled into the program, thinking that, you know, I would pretty much spend the rest of my days working in the field. And I think
that's fine for some.
Wait, right? Which is perfectly fine at
maybe many.
For many. But after I had started my apprenticeship program and learned more about how, you know, my apprenticeship program credits would be able to transfer into college credits and things like that, it kind of educated me and told me that there were more paths, you know, after working in the field that I could, you know, eventually own my own business if I wanted to.
And you didn't feel any paths cut off from yourself?
No, sir.
Great, sir. Thank you very much. And Mr. Bates, talking about my subcommittee, we got great members on it. We held a hearing where we heard about the need for meaningful engagement among the business community in designing effective CTE programs and helping students to explore careers available. And I've toured several programs. Can you please list some of the equipment and training that Perkins should make eligible, especially the equipment? Is there some kind of eligible use for Perkins money that would be advisable at this point?
Yes, I mean, we have used Perkins money at our local community college to purchase some of the training and equipment that is used in our lab, hydraulic trainers, pneumatic trainers, welding simulators and welding equipment are all necessary for the proper training.
Is there anything we're missing?
At this time, I'm not aware of anything, no.
Okay. And keeping on with you, Mr. Bates, you describe how, in your testimony, how the AMT program expanded from one partnership between the plant and a college to now approximately 400 students.
Yes.
Partnered with 160 companies. Given the rapid growth of the program, how have you preserved the quality? Any growing pains or anything?
Well, there's always growing pains in any situation. I think the one way that we've been able to preserve the quality of the curriculum is that we continue to be involved. We are regularly meeting with our local community college, not only on an annual basis, but we have quarterly instructions with our maintenance leaders at our local plants. They're talking and sitting down with the local education leaders and understanding what the technology is, making sure that we have the right equipment, and making sure that the curriculum is teaching what is necessary for the future.
So, basic communication and leadership?
Absolutely.
Thank you, all three of you, for your leadership. I yield.
Gentleman yields back. Ms. Davis, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I really do appreciate the hearing today. I think it reminds us that there's a lot of work to be done out there, but on the other hand, there are best practices around the country, and I think often the problem is how do you scale that? And how do you engage, and when you look at reauthorizations, what is it that is not necessarily prescriptive, but guides school districts, guides states throughout the country to do something that really has great merit down the line? And I wonder if there are just a few things. We've a lot of great comments, and really your responses have been wonderful. employability skills. We've talked a lot about technical skills, but we know that employability skills are very, very important in how people are able to relate to one another in the workplace as well as to the task in front of them. Without, again, being prescriptive, because I know that people, you know, push back on those kinds of things, what do you think is critical in the reauthorization language that speaks to that, to the issue of employability? We sometimes call them social-emotional skills. How do you have the confidence often to even take risks in setting and to talk about, you know, how, what the options are? How do you talk through that? It's communication, but it's a lot of things. Do you have some thoughts about that?
The employability skills component is one that we've spent a great deal of time in Louisiana looking at, and one of the things that we have determined is the most important, or the biggest step that we could take, is to have the actual employers in front of classrooms teaching employability skills. Because after all, they're the very same people that will be interviewing them, that will be reviewing their resume and materials, and that will also be working with them on a daily basis to determine whether they can continue with the organization. So having that partnership there in a real and substantive way, having them in the classroom interfacing with students is certainly important.
Yeah, and at what point do you think that's a good idea?
As early in the program as possible, and one of the things that we've also been able to do is to place in certain programs capstone courses so that industry has an opportunity not only to come in and teach employability skills, but you can also bet that they're doing a little bit of work trying to determine which of those students they want to hire first. One great example, a partner of ours, Praxair, has made substantial investments in Louisiana, particularly around the welding program area, but they've also been really valuable to us in teaching our students employability skills.
Mr. Bates, did you want to comment?
Yes, I think those employment skills are absolutely essential, and as Dr. Sullivan mentioned, it needs to happen from the very beginning. In our AMT programs, before they even start their technical questions, they're going through what is it to be a professional in the workplace, and so they're learning about what an employer expects from their team members. They're learning about the importance of punctuality. They're learning about the importance of asking good questions. They're learning about the importance of being dressed appropriately for the workplace. So we teach that prior to the program even beginning, and the expectation is that the students will not only be that way in their cooperative work experience, but they're also going to act that way in the classroom. And the professors are expecting that as well in the classroom.
So a lot of that be called out in legislation, or you think employability skills is a catch-all phrase that people can respond to?
I think if we, employment skills or employability skills, I think most educators and industry people understand what that means, mm-hmm. and I think it's important to encourage that in any type of legislation.
One of the other issues that we've talked about is teaching the teachers, and I know that it makes so much difference when a company, for example, has a program for young people. We have one for middle school. Qualcomm does this in San Diego. And the key is really that they engage the teachers early, months in advance, before the students come, and then the teachers participate, and then they're able to do it afterwards. That's unusual, I think. It's great. How do you see us trying to incorporate that into whether it's grant programs that perhaps companies can engage in? Obviously, Toyota does it with small businesses. How would you scale that? How would you find a way that we engage the teachers early and then they're able to continue to have the enthusiasm for the programs that the students have done?
In Louisiana, we have a program every summer that we refer to as Super Summer Institute, where we bring together faculty members from all over Louisiana to earn the next level certification, to learn that next skill set. But one of the tandem pieces to that is to be able to partner those faculty with industry partners so that they have an experience beforehand and after the certification is earned. It gives perspective, I think, to what they're learning and to the certification that they're earning.
Yeah.
Gentlelady's time has expired. I want to welcome Mr. Langevin to our hearing, and without objection, he will be allowed to ask questions of our witnesses following questioning from our committee members, and we still have a couple of those left. Mr. Byrne, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Sullivan, I'm the former Chancellor of Post-Secondary Education, State of Alabama, former Chairman of the State Workforce Planning Council, so I know what you do, and thank you for what you do. It's hard work. I was also on the state school board for 8 years, so I saw CTE and Perkins on both sides, K-12 and post-secondary. One of the things that I've seen up here in Washington is that there are plenty of things we're doing up here that we don't do very well and we waste money on. This is not one of them. I'm sure we can do it better, and that's what partly this is all about, is to learn how we can do it better, how we can do it better so you can do your job better, because we don't train anybody here. You do. And we need to make sure that we're giving you everything we possibly can to help you train people, because we treat poor people in America like they've got some sort of a incurable disease. There's no way to lift them out of poverty, so we just feed them a bunch of money to take care of the symptoms of poverty, instead of saying we can lift you out of poverty. And what you do every day is lift people out of poverty. I mean, being from Alabama, Louisiana, I know what you're doing. And it's really, I call it magic. You take somebody, probably the first person in their family has ever done anything in a post-secondary environment. You take them from having no employable skill to having an employable skill, and they go from being somebody with nothing to being somebody. And that's something that we ought to be all about here in government in Washington, and sometimes we get all gummed up in other things and miss that very important point. We did something we'd called dual enrollment, where we had kids in the high schools, public high schools, people dually enrolled in our two-year colleges. And so literally they could graduate from high school and in the same month get their, if it was a one-year welding certificate, their certificate, or get an associate's degree in a high-demand field. And that seemed to work for us. But we struggled in getting people interested in technical education because we told everybody you got to go get a four-year bachelor's degree in order to be successful. Well, Mr. Say is an example of where that's just not true. And so, Mr. Say, I wanted to ask you a question. I know you were thinking, there he was, he was talking to Dr. Sullivan, all of a sudden he asked me a question. How far back should we start with young people in school, I'm talking about before they get to a post-secondary environment? How far should we go back, before high school?
As I mentioned before, I think as early as possible. I think middle school is a good start.
Like seventh grade, is as early as that?
Yeah, as early as that. I think at that point, people begin to, I think you can kind of see how a student or how a young kid is doing academically at that point, and also look at, you know, what his interests are, his or her interests are. And I think you should be able to open up those doors for them to explore and decide for themselves of what they want to do in terms of higher education, whether it's going through a CTE program or going to college. I think that's a start. That's a starting point.
And you're in the construction field, is that right? Well, HVAC?
Correct, which is directly related to construction.
And so we probably couldn't teach seventh graders all the skills that you're required to by regulatory law to do everything in HVAC, but we could start them with some more basic type construction general skills, I guess?
Sure.
And I would think that would apply to some other areas, don't you think, Dr. Sullivan, that we could branch out to?
Absolutely. You mentioned the dual enrollment opportunities. By the way, commencement, this season of commencement that it is as close to a religious experience as you can have.
It really is.
You have that opportunity to go back to your district and experience commencement. It's certainly important. But I do think that as we think about dual enrollment and we think about how far to go back into the curriculum, that just very basic career exploration is so very important. I have daughters at home, and I can tell you at sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, so very important that they understand what careers are available to them.
You know, I had nursing, associate degree nursing programs under us, and I couldn't figure out why we had a high attrition rate. So I brought the nursing deans in, and I said, what's the deal here? We've got high demand for the nurses. Got big waiting lists, yet we're not succeeding. And they said that too many of the nursing students were coming into the program with inadequate levels of science preparation in high school, and so they couldn't hack the rather significant amount of science that these nurses had. Are we seeing that in other fields as well, Dr. Sullivan?
You know, I think it sort of hits at the question, this national discussion that we have around student success. And I think we've spent far too much time thinking about how we push more students through a program and far too little time thinking about the economic pull that would pull people through programs. If we offer the programs that have the appropriate amount of economic pull in the marketplace. I think of our process technology programs. These are the folks who operate facilities up and down the river in the state of Louisiana. So important to our economy. We don't have a completion problem in those programs because those folks are ending those programs earning $60,000, $65,000 a year in the very first year. So I think that our focus is probably much more well-placed if we think about program alignment and offering the correct programs in the market.
Great advice. Thank you. Appreciate you being here. Yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Mr. Desaunier, recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It really is a pleasure to be here and hear that consensus and the sense of urgency. When we see great programs, as some of my colleagues have talked about, it is sort of spiritual, as you mentioned, Dr. Sullivan. I have programs in my district, and many people don't realize that in the Bay Area we do still have industry, and in the East Bay we have significant industry, so much that we frequently hear from our major employers like Chevron and Shell and Dow that they have jobs that they can't fill because there aren't enough qualified young people. So we've tried to create, and we've successfully created, wonderful career academies. There's nothing like going into a disadvantaged community in high school and see 25, 30 kids and the message that sends to the other 1,000 kids that there's a career out there where they can be an electrician or a member of the UA, go out there and be a welder and make $65,000, $75,000 a year, particularly in a high-cost area. So that's wonderful. We have great programs with those companies, the community college and the school board. But the balance, Dr. Sullivan, you got to this in your initial comments about proper oversight and performance, I think is where we sometimes struggle. So the proper role for the federal government, and I don't disagree, we should give more discretion to states and local government, but having been in the legislature and having been in the middle of a very difficult battle between, and I remember private industry councils and workforce investment boards, where the Chamber of Commerce for the state and the Labor Fed, one of their most important piece of legislation was requiring workforce investment boards to actually have a minimum amount of their budget go to career tech and training. But we had a heck of a fight because there are a lot of fiefdoms where people, when the federal government, in my view, just abdicates its role. So this goes to the balance. It's not saying we should overly strict. But somewhere in there, Dr. Sullivan, strikes me you have some experience in this. This is sort of the porridge is holding people accountable so they don't feel as if they can do whatever they want with the money around performance standards and what the federal government's role is to make sure that's done.
Oh, the great question, and this is one of the areas that we're most proud of in Louisiana that we've done a great deal of work. We have been able to leverage the occupational forecast that our state completes every 2 years and begins a six-year look outward as to what the occupational forecast is by occupation. Once we had that data, we were then able to tier and base that data depending upon demand. And so now our work is about funding the occupations and the programs that feed the occupations where there is greatest demand. It seems like a relatively simple concept. It can be difficult because obviously there are those programs that will become not as prevalent in the demand market, and yet they're programs that have been traditional programs at institutions. We have to be willing to make the hard decisions. When we talked earlier about the difficulty of spending, spending is perhaps a problem, but as was pointed out here, it's not a problem as it relates to Perkins because we're investing in people. We have to ensure that those people who are completing those programs are actually going to be able to earn the jobs that get them to that vision or dream that they have for themselves.
Mr. Bates, I sometimes hear from the private sector the cultural struggle of making sure the money's spent right. So in the gestalt of getting these partnerships right, getting the public agencies to work with private agencies, do you have any sort of insights as to what makes your program work and what would add value?
Well, I think the way that we have it made, we're making it work is that we're involved from the very beginning, that we have good communication between the various partners, and we have good communication with our local education provider. That's been critical. And it's not an easy task. It required a lot of people willing to say that we have to look at the bigger picture of how we can provide a very robust program for our community so that we can then have the future workforce that is necessary. So we've had to give up a little turf at times for the benefit of making sure that the program can be successful.
Mr. Say, I loved your testimony. As you were growing up and going through these decision-making thresholds, it strikes me that a lot of it is just the stigma. So kids are led to believe that they're not going to be successful unless they become a doctor, a lawyer, go to a four-year school. Could you speak a little bit more to that and your personal journey overcoming that?
So in general, my parents, I think that your parents play one of the biggest parts of the stigma, because even today, I mean, I think we ask ourselves honestly, I mean, I think that still persists in these conversations with our children growing up, mm-hmm. is that you should be going to a four-year college. I certainly wouldn't be teaching my kid that in the future, but I think that is a very that is step one. Step one is all the parents that are basically guiding all their kids growing up, they should be the first ones to provide them the opportunity and encouragement to go and learn something outside of going to a four-year college.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Mr. Grothman.
First of all, just a general comment. I disagree a little bit with one of the comments made by one of the people who questioned before. I don't think in America we ever remotely give up on poor people. I mean, we go out of the way to offer many programs to poor people that, quite frankly, the middle class people don't have. And you know, if you want to start out at the bottom, you know, America is the place to succeed. I want to come back and agree with largely the tenor of what you guys have said. My district has more manufacturing jobs in it than anywhere else in the country, and probably the biggest challenge my employers face is finding people to work. They all have so many jobs out there which can't be filled. Now, my first question is for Mr. Sullivan, Dr. Sullivan. I recently had some tradesmen in my office, and they talked about all the people going back to begin their apprentice training at 26, 27, 28, who previously had a four-year degree. I also, when I talk to my local tech schools, find people going back to tech school after they already have a four-year degree. Do you find that's true in your area as well?
Absolutely, it's true. And in fact, we've begun programs that specifically target that population at Sewella Technical Community College in the southwest part of the state of Louisiana in response to a demand or need for more workforce from Sasol, a large partner that located there. We were able to go out and find those people who had completed a baccalaureate degree, help them to finish a process technology program in a matter of 16 weeks, really is able to answer an immediate market demand and also help someone who has earned a baccalaureate degree to earn a great living for their families.
Okay. Do you therefore feel that we have too many people going to four-year college in this country?
You know, I don't know that we can ever say that there are too many people pursuing education, but I can tell you that we do have an alignment problem in this country. We certainly need to begin to think more in terms of what value proposition we're able to bring to our students. And also, I think the great equalizer in this, as was pointed out a few minutes ago, is having industry involved in those decisions about what programs we're funding.
Well, but the point is, to me, fairly obviously, if I have some poor kid who, you know, was taken in by a fancy brochure and graduates with an undergrad degree with 50 grand in debt, and then he's going to begin his tech school degree or his apprenticeship at age 26 or 27, it would seem to me obvious that he made a mistake, both time-wise and cost-wise, going to a four-year, correct?
Absolutely. Mom and Dad would probably agree as well.
Right. If that's so, do you think it would be a good idea? I mean, one of the problems we have around here is we're very in debt. Okay, just went over $19 trillion in debt. And you guys are going to want to ask this program to be reauthorized. Do you think it would be a good idea to maybe take money away from, say, the Pell Grants going through the additional 4 years and find the money to continue your program there?
Certainly, certainly believe that there are better ways to spend the Pell dollar, and it's certainly a discussion we look forward to engaging in with around the Higher Education Act discussion at the appropriate time. As it relates to the Perkins reauthorization, I do think there are opportunities here to extend that alignment question, which I think ultimately will drive some of the changes that you're describing.
Okay. Another question. You mentioned the wonderful things that are going on in Louisiana with your program. One of the frustrations I have here is too many of my colleagues think because something that's a good idea, it's a federal problem, okay? And, you know, obviously we've got a federal program here. You say you're doing a good job in Louisiana, but you also mentioned several changes you want to have towards our program. It would seem to me easier to get those changes through the Louisiana legislature than asking Congress to do it. Don't you feel it would be maybe better insofar as we have to put more money in these sorts of programs if it came from the state rather than the federal government?
Certainly there are those programs in the state of Louisiana, and I'm sure in other states where we're funding career and technical education. We have something referred to as the Rapid Response Fund in Louisiana, the WISE Fund, a number of others where we're targeting those resources at programs exactly like Perkins. So instead of an either or, I think it's most appropriately a balanced approach, state investment as well as federal investment.
Well, as you mentioned, with the Perkins grants come certain strings, Okay, so you have to send the money to us from Louisiana, then send it back to Louisiana with strings and paperwork involved. Wouldn't it be preferable, insofar as you wanted more money, just to get it straight from the state of Louisiana than asking the federal government to give you the money?
No, perhaps it would. I think the most important part is to remain focused on the fact that we need investments in career and technical education programs, because the long-term impact, as you pointed out very well, as we're talking about people in poverty, is to invest in those folks to give them the opportunity to pull themselves out of poverty.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentleman's time has expired. Mr. Polis, you're recognized.
Thank you. My first question is for Mr. Bates. In my district, St. Vrain Valley School District is opening a Pathways in Technology Early College, or PTEC, school, and PTEC allows students to earn their high school diploma and an associate's degree in the STEM field in 6 years. And PTEC in St. Vrain is a partnership between the school district, Front Range Community College, and IBM. Can you talk more about the role of employers like IBM or Toyota in Perkins, and how schools like PTEC can be developed to give students STEM skills that can be applied at multiple companies meeting workforce needs?
Yes, thank you, Congressman. I think industry can be involved first and foremost by educating educators what the technology is out there, what technology is necessary for the future workforce. So that's one area that we can provide. We can let folks, educators, understand the type of technology and the type of education that's important for the future. The other way I think industry can be involved in is helping to fund and provide equipment for that technology. Toyota has, throughout the country, donated not only manufacturing equipment, but we've also donated automobiles to various technical schools so that students can have the state-of-the-art equipment to be able to work on. I also know that there's been other local manufacturers in my community who's donated welding equipment for the students to work on. So employers have to be involved in helping to ensure that the technology that's being taught is state of the art and it's current, helping to help develop the curriculum and also be able to provide funding to help purchase equipment and other things for them to be successful in their work.
Dr. Sullivan, in my district in Colorado, high schools and community colleges have built relationships together that give students a chance to take advantage of high-quality CTE programs. Can you talk about the importance of dual and concurrent enrollment programs in this partnership, and at the federal level, what we can do to encourage these kinds of programs?
Absolutely, and certainly Colorado has been a leader in that effort, and we appreciate the example that you've established. You know, as I mentioned before, this is that season of commencement, and over this past week, we've had numerous examples of students. A student at Nunez Community College this past week who not only earned a high school diploma, but also earned a credential in industrial maintenance technology and is looking at a career working right there in the Chalmette area of Louisiana, working for any number of different companies, Phillips 66, Domino Sugar, Community Coffee, a whole range of organizations there that are looking for those specific skill sets. And so the career and technical education opportunities, you have to remember that many of these students, as much as we may want to believe that they're listening to guidance counselors, are listening to their colleagues and fellow students more so than they are guidance counselors. And so the word of mouth and the example that these students set for one another is really an important component for us to think about as we establish policy.
And can you briefly address how greater economies of scales and better services can be offered at a better cost to school districts through partnering with community colleges versus trying to run all these programs themselves?
You know, the school accountability movement in this nation has probably made career and technical education more difficult in this environment. And so as we begin to think about how we scale, community colleges present unique opportunities, I believe, because they are the institutions that are aware of and involved in local labor market demands. But in addition to that, they are also the entities that are the connectedness between the secondary arena as well as the universities, and present unique opportunities, I think, to do exactly what you're describing in terms of scale.
Thank you. And in terms of, for any of you, what are some of the more innovative CTE programs across the country that you've seen that you want to share with our committee?
Well, I can speak to, I think that our our program that we have across the country. It's been recognized by the Jennifer McNeely of the National Associate or Manufacturing Institute as being the premier associate's degree in industrial maintenance across the country. So I think that's our program is a great example. The great thing about our program is not just benefits Toyota, but it benefits all manufacturers who want to be a part of it.
Has anybody seen any effective CT programs for like call centers or customer service or anything like that? No, that would be another area where I think would be a good opportunity for kids to be able to graduate high school with a marketable degree. There's a lot of growth in that sector, including one of the largest call center companies based in my district in Colorado. And happy to yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Mr. Langevin, you're recognized for 5 minutes. It's good to see you here, Jim.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank you and Ranking Member Scott and Acting Ranking Member Fudge for the invitation to join you and for the ability to participate in this hearing on an issue that's really near and dear to my heart when we talk about the work on reauthorizing Perkins. I also want to thank my Republican co-chairman of the CTE Caucus, a distinguished member of this committee, Congressman G.T. Thompson. He and I have been great partners in this effort, and he's been a steadfast partner, again, and a strong advocate for strengthening our workforce training programs. Thank you to the witnesses for your very impressive testimony, and I've enjoyed sitting in on this hearing. If I could start, Mr. Bates, one of the biggest challenges we've seen in my home state of Rhode Island is getting companies to offer apprenticeships that also allow students to pursue their studies at a community college. What changes did you need to make that allowed you to onboard these students without a disruption to your production process?
Well, one thing that we had to do, Congressman, in our program is we had to provide them with the work experience that would also allow them to be able to go to school. At our facility, we rotate our schedules, which means every 2 weeks our team members are changing their schedules. That wouldn't be feasible for our co-op students. So we had to work with them and be able to make sure that they were able to have the time necessary to go 2 days a week to their schooling and then be able to have the training the three other days a week on day shift and be able to get the applied training that they needed. We had to work with our existing maintenance workforce to be able to make sure that they always had a mentor, no matter who was on shift with them, that they always had a mentor that they could work with to teach them, to make sure that they were being safe and they were able to provide guidance to them. So it does require some requirements for the manufacturer to change how they are able to do the work for those students. But if you think about it, this is an investment in their future, but it's also an investment in our future. I need those students in 3 to 5 years to be able to come into the workforce and to provide a valuable skill to my plant. And we have to recognize that. So we need to make sure that we are providing that opportunity for them to get the skills and the education necessary so that when they graduate, they're able to then come into the workplace and provide the skill that I'm looking for.
Thank you. Dr. Sullivan, so I have a question for you about coordination between educators and employers, and I know that we've kind of touched on this a little bit throughout the hearing, different ways, but at a CTE caucus field hearing in Rhode Island, we were told that colleges need to move at the speed of business if they want to offer successful apprenticeship programs. What enables a college to effectively tailor their classes to in-demand skills?
Thank you for the question, and I think it really begins very, very simply on the front end with listening. By simply asking the industry the question, what is it that you're looking for and how should we deliver it, and listening when industry responds. The traditional academic calendar probably is out the window, as we just heard Mr. Bates describe a second ago, because we have to begin to think about how we deliver instruction on time and in the right place and of the right quality and type. To ensure that those employees or those apprenticeship students, as they complete, are actually the product that industry is looking for. So listening would be first and foremost. Secondly, having the willingness to be flexible and to make adjustments to what we think of as being traditional in our institutions, and instead remember that we are in the business of trying to help our students become employed. And because that is our business, we have to be flexible, and be it with schedule, be it with content, but at the same time, knowing that industry is there because there is an investment that they are making in our institutions, we have to be willing to reciprocate.
really is a partnership. I agree. Thank you. And for Mr. Say, in your testimony, you note that it was a family member who suggested you pursue a skilled trade. What could the school district have done to encourage more students to think about a similar path? Did you encounter any barriers preventing you from pursuing a skilled trade as a viable option for you and your peers? I know we touched on that just a minute ago in a way, but anything else you want to expand upon in that respect?
I feel that in general, thankfully, my uncle, who happened to be a roofer, kind of persuaded me to go and start looking in the CTE programs that was available to me. But I feel that schools could do a better job at kind of advertising, not advertising, but promoting that these programs exist. Instead of me having to go outreach to them in finding this program through my guidance counselor, I think there should have been something out there, whether it's a kind of like a career day almost for teachers and counselors to come through to students and show them that, hey, by the way, that these programs are available to you. And that could easily spark some interest in younger kids.
Gentleman's time has expired.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Looks like all members have had a chance to engage in the discussion. Let me yield to Ms. Fudge for any closing remarks she might have.
Thank you very much, and thank all of you for being here today. It's been a great hearing. I think that both sides of the aisle are pleased with the testimony that we have received, and I thank you all. Mr. Chairman, I would request that we enter into the record a letter from the National Education Association in support of reauthorization, as well as recommendations for our consideration.
Without objection.
Thank you. Just in closing, I would say that this is a very timely hearing. I'm certainly hopeful that having heard the testimony today, as well as the comments and questions from my colleagues, that we can move forward to get this reauthorization done this year. I don't see that there is any impediment to doing it, and I'm certainly hopeful that we will make it happen this year. And I thank you, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlelady. I want to thank the witnesses. Really compelling stories, great witnesses. I couldn't help comment. I was talking to Ms. Fudge a little bit here. We were kibitzing a bit, and how many of my colleagues and how many of you mentioned welding? And I flash back to eighth grade shop when I ostensibly learned welding, and I'm thinking, gosh, if I still had that skill, you know, then I could probably have a real job. It's amazing. You can weld, you can work anywhere. And then Mr. Langevin mentioned the caucus where someone said that the programs, the schools have to work at the speed of business. And I think that is something that we're going to be very mindful of as we go forward here to remove any impediments that might be there so that the instruction can move at that speed. There's no point in you, the need is out there and you're still teaching, something that is no longer of any use. I almost said welding, but I just made the point that that is of great use today. And so we are excited about the prospect of reauthorizing this. I think this is one of those areas where we should have pretty good bipartisan agreement. Your testimony today and your involvement in the discussion is very helpful. So again, I thank you very much. And there being no further business, the committee stands adjourned.